We are internally related to everything,
yes.
Not externally related. Consciousness is an internal relationship to the whole. We take in the whole, and we act toward the whole. And
yeah.
That internal, whatever we have taken in, determines basically what we are.
Quantum physicist and philosopher David Bohm was profoundly affected by his close contacts with both Einstein and Jay Krishnamurti. Bohm's theory of wholeness and the implicate order states that there is something like life and mind enfolded in everything.
Well, you see, I think the difficulty is this fragmentation, first of all. Everybody is, all thought is broken up into bits, like this nation, this country, this industry, this profession, and so on, as they can't meet, right? And it's extremely hard to break into that. Now, the second, but that comes about primarily because thought has developed traditionally in a way such that it claims not to be affecting anything, but just telling you the way things are. Therefore, people cannot see that they are creating a problem and then apparently trying to solve it. That is, see, let's take the problem, what problem do you like, pollution, or the ecology. See, the ecology is not in itself a problem. It works perfectly well by itself. It's due to us, right? It's a problem because we are thinking in a certain way by breaking everything up and each person's doing his own thing. Right? Now, therefore, the ecological problem is due to thought, right? But thought thinks it is a problem out there and I must solve it. Now, that doesn't make sense because simultaneously thought is doing all the activities which make the problem and then does another set of activities to try to overcome it. You see, it doesn't stop doing the things which are making the ecological problem, right? Or the national problem, or whatever the problem is. The Earth is one household, really.
Yeah.
We're not treating it that way, right? So that's the first step in economics, is to say the Earth is one household and all that it depends on. It's all one, you see. So now the implicate order would help us to see that, to see everything enfolds everything. That everybody not merely depends on everybody, but actually everybody is everybody in a deeper sense. See, we are the Earth because all our substance comes from the Earth and goes back. I mean, it's wrong to say it's an environment, you see, just surrounding us, because that would be like trying the brain regarding the stomach as part of its environment.
Or the root of the word compassion, you see, to feel together. And if people have the same feeling together and are responsible for each other, then you have compassion.
And you don't think it's part of, what's the word, original sin, that human beings in their very nature compete?
Well, I don't think that there is such thing as original sin, and I think it has developed more and more with the growth of our society, that there's no evidence that people in the hunter-gatherer society were all that competitive, but the more you made society big and you had organization and you had to get to the top, mm-hmm. the people on the bottom would suffer, there was a drive to compete, naturally.
And do you think that perhaps the desire to compete is a weakness?
Not a weakness, that's a mistake.
Right.
So the first thing we have to do in the long run is to look at our whole way of thinking, which has developed over so many thousands of years. I don't think it was the original way of thinking of the human race at all, but for many complex reasons it came about. Now, that means that people have to make a... they have to participate to make a cooperative effort to have a dialogue, a real dialogue in which we will not merely exchange opinions, but actually listen deeply to the views of other people without resistance. And we cannot do this if we hold to our own opinion and resist the other. It doesn't mean we should accept the other, but we have to be able to look at all the opinions as suspended, as it were, in front of us, without carrying them out, without suppressing them.
Yes, but this wholeness, this new consciousness, this wholeness, is that something that you can only glimpse? Perhaps in, like, as you might have a glimpse of heaven, or is it something scientific? I mean, can you think your way through it?
Not really completely. The wholeness is an attitude or an approach, but it can be given a scientific realization, you see. Because of relativity and quantum theory, we can, if we wish, look on the world as a whole.
See, I began more or less accepting the ideas of Niels Bohr. I wrote a book called Quantum Theory based on that. And I was feeling that the question really was, what is the nature of reality? You see, Bohr's view is based on an epistemology of saying that all we can discuss is our knowledge of reality.
Yeah.
And and I felt dissatisfied with that finally. Well, because it did not give any clear concept of reality. You see, it only discussed what could be observed and measured. Now, if you said, okay, that's all it is, then we'd say we will accept it on that basis, but then we would raise the question, what can we say? Well, reality would mean something that would have some existence independently of being known. You see, to say it might be that we would know it, but it did not require that we know it in order to exist.
Yeah.
Now, it was difficult to see how this could be sustained, finally, in Bohr's view. Now, I tried to get some idea of what might be the process which was implied by the mathematics of the quantum theory. And this process is what I call enfoldment, that the mathematics itself suggests a movement in which everything, in which any particular element of space may have a field which unfolds into the whole, and the whole folds and enfolds into it. So you have this movement, and I call this the implicate or enfolded order, which unfolds into the explicate order where everything is separate. Now, the implicate order, everything is internally related to everything. Everything contains everything, right? So everybody has many experiences of this implicate order. The most obvious one is ordinary consciousness, where consciousness enfolds everything that you know or see, right? And now, it doesn't merely enfold the universe, but also you act according to that content. So therefore, you are internally related to the whole. In this sense, you act according to your consciousness of the whole. So you're not acting mechanistically in the sense of being pushed and pulled by objects in the surroundings, but rather according to your consciousness of them, you act.
Yeah.
So if you're not conscious of them, you cannot act intelligently toward them. But the consciousness is really our most immediate experience of this implicate order. And you may think of nets of consciousness that are finer and finer, or we may think of capturing finer and finer aspects of the implicate order. I think there's an intelligence that's implicit there, you see, to say a kind of intelligence unfolds. The source of intelligence is not necessarily in the brain, you see, the ultimate source, but much more enfolded into the whole. Now, the question of what you want to call God, that depends on what you mean by the word, you see, because taking it as a personal God might restrict it in some way.
I think science has begun to replace religion as the major source of the world view. Therefore, if science takes a fragmentary world view, it will have a profound effect on consciousness.
But science is always seen as measurement. Is that no longer true?
Well, science is whatever people make of it. You see, science has changed over the ages, and it's different now from a few hundred years ago, and it could be different again. Now, there's no intrinsic reason why science must necessarily be measurement. This is another historical development which has come about over the past few centuries. It's entirely contingent and not absolutely necessary.
And when Einstein produced his special theory,
yeah,
which the Times newspaper of London dismissed as being nonsense, was he moving towards wholeness?
Yes, he definitely was. He moved eventually toward a view of field theory where everything was one field, all the fields merging. So it was a step toward wholeness, although not, you know, it was a limited step, but still it was the beginning.
And if we get to wholeness, are we then in heaven? I mean, where else is there to go? Oh,
we'll never get there, you see. It's not a place you can get. wholeness, I say, is a kind of attitude or an approach to the whole of life. It's a way, if we can have a coherent approach to reality, then reality will respond coherently to us. But nature has been tremendously affected by our way of thinking on the earth. Nature is now being destroyed. There's very little left on the earth which wasn't affected by how we were thinking.
And if we have coherence, in what way will our behavior be seen to be different?
Well, we will produce the results we intend rather than the results we don't intend.
Yes.
That's the first big change. Then we will be more orderly, harmonious, you know, we will be happier. I think we could put all that in there. But the major source of unhappiness is that we are incoherent and therefore producing results that we don't really want. And then trying to overcome them while we keep on producing them. The question is, what is the real origin of consciousness?
That's exactly the case. Where did it come from? Was there a time when there was no consciousness?
Well, I don't think it originates in time. You see, as I think it's a potential of the whole universe. Wholeness will arise between us all in participation rather than in separately.
But if you went as a hermit into a cave...
Well, you still have nature.
That's true.
We are internally related to everything,
yes.
Not externally related. Consciousness is an internal relationship to the whole. We take in the whole, and we act toward the whole. And yeah. That internal, whatever we have taken in, determines basically what we are. I read somewhere that the hunter-gatherers would get all their food in about 15 hours a week. Mm-hmm. Now, and we have not yet approached anything like that. So. Leaving that aside, I think we need to set aside some time for this. We need a period of emptiness and quiet where we can go into this. It doesn't mean that we should do nothing else. I think that you have to be sensitive to just the question of delusion. That is there incoherence? You have to be sensitive to incoherence. Now, delusion arises when we are not sensitive to incoherence, when we overlook it. There's no guarantee that we can succeed in anything. If anybody claims to have evidence, it's always limited, and you can't trust it either. So in this game, there's no guarantee at all. As we can't trust anybody to tell us what's about these things. They have a tremendous resistance to acknowledging incoherence. People are constantly saying everything is all right, there's nothing to worry about, you know, this is all very coherent. Totalitarian regimes are constantly doing that, saying everything is wonderful. That's the key point, to attend to incoherence, first acknowledge it, and then begin to do something about it.
It has to go in waves, I must say. It has to go in waves, you know. There's a time...
Everything is in waves, he says.
No, I said there's a time for anarchy, and there's a time for order. Order creates anarchy, and anarchy creates order.
And
it goes in waves.
Waves create erosion.
I think that the incoherence has become more dangerous because of the scale of our society and because of technology, that we have all sorts of dangers such as nuclear war, biological war, chemical war, destruction of nature, and probably we can think of four or five others which are brought about by our power. You see, now the greater power we have, the greater we need coherence. The question to my mind is the human being capable of dealing with this situation which he himself has produced?